So I'd like to start the hearing by calling on the presentation from Ontario Power Generation as outlined in Commission Members Document 15H8.1 and H8.1A. I understand that Mr. Glenn Yager will make the presentation. Over to you, sir.
Good afternoon, President Binder and members of the Commission. My name is Glenn Yager, OPG's Nuclear President and Chief Nuclear Officer. I've worked for OPG and OPG's predecessor company, Ontario Hydro, for the past 34 years at both sites, and have held various positions, including being certified as a shift manager, Director of Operations and Maintenance, and most recently, Site Vice President at Pickering Nuclear Generating Station, and now the Chief Nuclear Officer. As head of OPG Nuclear, I am responsible for ensuring our nuclear plants are operated to the highest standards and that safety remains our number one priority. I'll be here for most of today, but regret I have to return to Toronto for a board meeting later today. I have here with me today Brian Duncan, the Senior Vice President of Darlington Nuclear. Brian is responsible for the safe and reliable operations of the Darlington Station. He joined Ontario Hydro in 1980 as a nuclear operator and has held a variety of increasingly responsible positions at the Bruce, Pickering, and Darlington nuclear stations. Brian lives in Whitby with his wife and three kids. Also here with me today is Dietmar Reiner, the Senior Vice President of Nuclear Projects, who is overseeing the Darlington refurbishment. Dietmar joined Ontario Hydro as an engineer in 1985. He has held a number of increasingly senior positions in the company's nuclear, hydroelectric, and power systems operations divisions, as well as corporate support functions. Dietmar and his wife had recently moved to Curtis. Also with me today providing support is Lori Swamy, Senior Vice President of Decommissioning and Nuclear Waste Management, and Steve Woods, our Chief Nuclear Engineer. We're here today in support of our request for a license renewal of the Darlington Station, which expires on December 31st, 2015, and we've requested a renewed license term for 13 years. I'll start off today's presentation with a brief overview of Ontario Power Generation and our extensive engagement in our local community. And I'll speak briefly about our Darlington plant and how proud I am of the performance of this plant. It's one of the best performing nuclear stations in the world. Brian Duncan will then expand on the performance at the Darlington Station in the CNSC safety and control areas, in areas like radiation safety, environmental protection, human performance, physical design, and safety improvements. We will show that our performance to date and the programs we have in place will ensure performance is maintained at a high standard throughout the next license period. Dietmar Reiner will then provide an overview of our current refurbishment activities, the facilities we're constructing, the scope of the work, and the timelines involved. This timeline is at the heart of our request for a 13-year license. We believe a 13-year license is the safest way to manage refurbishment. It would allow all four Darlington units to be refurbished under the same set of regulatory requirements, and that would improve nuclear safety through consistency and configuration management between the units. And finally, I'll wrap up the presentation with a brief summary. We have a few short videos throughout the presentation that I hope you'll find both informative and useful. The Darlington Nuclear Station forms part of the backbone of the electricity supply to Ontario, Canada's economic engine. Along with Pickering and Bruce Power, nuclear provides Ontario with about 50% of its power. This power is reliable, it's affordable, and it's one of the lowest greenhouse gas emitting sources of power available in Ontario and worldwide. Not only that, the Darlington Station was the first station outside of the U.S. to be recognized by its industry peers as one of the top performing stations in the world, and the first station to receive that recognition for two consecutive evaluations. For these reasons, nuclear power from Darlington will continue to supply Ontario for decades to come, and we continue to invest in the station to ensure its ongoing safe operations. At the heart of this is our investment in the mid-life refurbishment of the station, one of the biggest infrastructure investments in Canada, and one of the most important. It's an investment we have been planning for years, and one that will take many years to complete. It will start in October of 2016 and finish in 2028. Once complete, though, the refurbishment of Darlington will continue to provide our children and our children's children with 20% of their electricity needs. Operating a major nuclear generating station alongside the largest project in our company's history requires a great deal of planning and oversight. We spent 6 years planning and benchmarking this refurbishment, which Dietmar will go through in more detail. Our benchmarking has shown that the real key to success is teamwork. As Chief Nuclear Officer, I'm responsible for the performance of the team in ensuring the safe operation of the plant and execution of the refurbishment program. In order to ensure this, we've recently reorganized. Today, the entire nuclear organization, from operations to projects to engineering, operate under a single nuclear management system and the president of OPG Nuclear. What that means is one engineering change control program, one nuclear safety program, one team, and one goal. As you know, no team can succeed without the support of those around them. Without the support of communities around us, we wouldn't be one of the top performing stations in the world, and we wouldn't be about to start refurbishment, and we wouldn't be requesting a 13-year license. The Darlington Station is located in First Nations territory, and OPG acknowledges the Haudenosaunee, Mississaugas, Ojibways, and the Huron. The waste produced at Darlington is stored in the traditional territory of Saugeen Ojibwe Nation. We are committed to maintaining and growing our relationships with them and 9 other First Nations and Métis communities that have shown an interest in our nuclear operations. This is in keeping with our First Nations and Métis relations policy that sets out objectives for respecting Aboriginal rights and interests and developing relationships and partnerships. As an example, we're leading a partnership with Aboriginal communities, industry, and unions to identify job opportunities in the region and build job skills among Aboriginal members to fill those jobs. We also have a 3-year program to increase Aboriginal participation in the refurbishment project. This program is supported by almost 30 representatives who will be matching a $250,000 annual contribution from the Ministry of Aboriginal Affairs to create Aboriginal apprenticeships. At a more fundamental level, we meet regularly with Métis and First Nations to consult on issues and concerns and to work on common areas of interest. These relationships continue to mature, and we're committed to further building trust and understanding with our First Nations and Métis partners. The understanding and support of First Nations and Métis is fundamental to another Darlington license that we need to operate to, and that's our social license, or the ongoing approval of the community and other stakeholders for our current and ongoing operations. This is not something we can get by appearing every 5 or 13 years. It requires a daily commitment. It means being part of the community, sharing its values, and supporting what matters to the community and to ourselves. In Clarington, that means meeting regularly with elected representatives and community members. It means joining organizations and boards, and partnering with dozens of environmental, educational, and community building groups. We believe in giving back to Clarington to improve the quality of life for the duration of our operations and beyond. It's a commitment we take seriously and that we demonstrate every day through our support of the community's safety and environmental causes, among others. Because employees like me don't just work in the region, we live there as well. Another part of our commitment to the community is through sharing information about our operations. We recognize that nuclear power remains mysterious to most outside the industry, and that the Darlington Station is largely separated from the community by fences and large berms. Key to our social license is understanding, and we work with the community to understand what information they would like to receive and how they want to receive it. And so we've developed multiple vehicles, from toll-free numbers to one-on-one briefings, to help the community understand our operation and any impacts it might have. Our visitor center at the Darlington Energy Complex doubles as a community meeting place, and our annual Open Doors events have attracted over 5,000 visitors in the past 2 years. Our last Open Doors event in June allowed visitors to tour through the reactor mock-up facility and the Darlington site. The feedback was overwhelming. And what it showed me was that the social license can go beyond simple approval of our operations. The community members that showed up were more than just passive supporters. They were advocates for the project, vested in the future of Darlington as much as we are. And there's a short video from that event that we have.
The Darlington station is an important part of the Clarington community, where support for the station is strong. 80% of Clarington residents have a positive impression of the station and support the refurbishment of Darlington Nuclear. OPG provides the community with regular updates on emergency preparedness, station operations, environmental topics, and current events in many ways, including newsletters, presentations, websites, and face-to-face meetings. OPG has conducted over 100 tours of the mock-up facility and has hosted public open houses where over 5,500 people have attended.
Well, yeah, it's a nuclear reactor mock-up. It's pretty awesome.
I didn't expect it to be this accurate and this big.
It's way bigger than I thought.
It's high-tech.
We had no idea compared to whatever we saw on TV, so this is really, really cool.
I wasn't expecting this when I first came in. I thought we'd just be reading about the reactors and whatever was happening, but then we got to see this real-life example about what is inside of each of the units.
As close as you're ever going to get to a reactor, and it's the real thing.
I'm visiting from England, and we've come to see relatives. I'm very pleased from what I see. If this is world standard, then, you know, I feel a bit more comfortable about it.
It reaffirmed my stance on it, that I think it's one of the best power generation techniques used.
You know, clean, safe power and lots of jobs for local communities, so I'm a big fan of that idea.
It's important. It's part of our future of Ontario for electricity, right?
Yeah, we support the renewal of license.
I assure that if OPG were to continue operating in high standards and being a world-class facility, that shouldn't be a problem to extend their license.
The support of the community is the result of years of safe operations, but it is also because of the open dialogue the station has with the local residents, First Nations and Métis communities, as well as business and community organizations.
Members of the Commission were requesting a license term of approximately 13 years from December 1st, 2028 to December 1st, 2028 to cover life extension activities, including refurbishment on all four of our reactor units. This is a significant investment of over $12 billion in a very complex project. Our Commission member document outlines why we conclude a 13-year license term is necessary, acceptable, and appropriate. Now, I'll highlight a few more of the more important points. A 13-year operating license is the safest way to manage refurbishment because it would allow all four Darlington units to be refurbished under the same set of regulatory requirements. This will enable us to assure nuclear safety through consistency and configuration management between the units. Our team at OPG has already completed comprehensive assessments to cover long-term operation well beyond December 2028, as described in the CNSC regulatory document RD360, Life Extension of Nuclear Power Plants. Significant investments and safety improvements have been made and will continue throughout the 13-year refurbishment project. And finally, Darlington is one of the top performing nuclear plants in the world. We're pleased that the CNSC has rated our station as fully satisfactory for the past 7 years. In addition, our international peer evaluations have consistently recognized our station's high performance. All of us at OPG remain committed to ensuring this will not change during the next license term. I'll now pass the presentation over to Brian Duncan, who will show how our performance to date and the programs we have in place will ensure performance is maintained at a high standard throughout the 13-year license period. Brian.
Thanks, Glenn. Brian Duncan, for the record. In my position as the Senior Vice President of Darlington Nuclear, I'm responsible for ensuring Darlington, the plant, is operated and maintained with safety as the overriding priority. Over the next few slides, I'll review the performance of the Darlington station for the CNSC's safety control areas. I'll start off by saying that across our nuclear fleet, safety is our core value. It underpins everything we do at our stations. Safe operations are at the heart of our social license and of our operating license. Our operations at Darlington continue to result in some of the best safety performance in Canada and among all nuclear power plants worldwide. Over the last licensing period, there were no radiation exposures at Darlington that exceeded our own dose limits, and our public radiation dose is just a fraction of the regulatory limit. Darlington also produces some of Ontario's most reliable, lowest cost electricity. We produce about 20% of Ontario's electricity at 5.7 cents a kilowatt hour. Only regulated hydro costs less. Our reactors are consistently named among the world's top performing CANDU units. As Glenn mentioned in his opening remarks, our performance has been recognized by our industry peers and in CNSC staff's most recent assessment of Canadian nuclear power plant performance. All of us remain focused on continuous improvement. The objective of our business plan is to continue Darlington's journey of excellence while positioning the station for refurbishment and beyond. That has been true up until now and will remain true throughout the license period. We're proud of our safety record and work hard to maintain a safe work environment. Our conventional safety performance remains strong. Darlington's all-injury rate has been better than target since 2010, and we recently achieved 5 million hours without a lost time accident. Although I'm pleased with that achievement, I'm not satisfied. So I will continue to focus on improving safety and demonstrate that personal safety, nuclear safety, and environmental safety are priorities that supersede all others. In recognition of our outstanding safety performance and programs, last year OPG received a Canadian Electrical Association Award for Safety Excellence for the third consecutive year. With respect to radiation safety, over the licensing period, there were no radiation exposures at Darlington that exceeded regulatory or our own much more stringent administrative dose limits. Collective radiation exposure is an industry standard measure. On an average over the last 3 years, our performance is significantly better than the CANDU industry standard. We attribute this success in a large part to our people and the programs and equipment they have developed to minimize radiation exposure. Some highlights include tritium dose reduction by innovative plant equipment alignments and the use of portable dryers, an industry best program for alpha hazard classification and control, a fourfold reduction in reactor face dose rates during outages was achieved by installing a combination of overhead shielding canopies and end-fitting shielding tiles. The use of remote real-time gamma and tritium monitors during outages has also reduced dose by minimizing the need for people to enter containment and manually perform routine gamma and tritium surveys. As I've mentioned, nuclear safety is paramount to all of us at Darlington. Central to this is the defense in depth concept, where multiple overlapping engineered, administrative, and people-based barriers are in place to protect the public, environment, and plant personnel. Our engineered barriers have a robust design, and our process and safety systems are highly reliable and well-maintained. But we learned from Fukushima that even the strongest defense in depth systems can be enhanced. We've taken the key lessons learned from that event and incorporated changes to further enhance our nuclear safety. Of particular note, we've implemented emergency mitigating equipment, or EME, which is a mobile and flexible means of providing cooling water to the reactor following a beyond design basis event or severe accident. I'm pleased to report that all items in the CNSC's Fukushima Action Plan have now been closed. But again, we've not stopped improving. In addition to our EME, we're currently installing 5 major safety improvements that will further improve our nuclear safety. I'll have more details on those later in the presentation. Our performance is also strong in all areas of environmental protection. Our targets for radiation dose to the public are much more stringent than regulatory limits, and we strive to keep them as low as reasonably achievable. To date, the public radiation dose from Darlington remains a fraction of 1% of the regulatory limit. We were the first nuclear generating station in North America to achieve environmental management system compliance with ISO 14001, environmental management. Our environmental monitoring programs in the vicinity of Darlington assess the impact of operations on the environment and human health. Annual results are made available to our community and the public on our website. In June of this year, Fisheries and Oceans Canada issued a Fisheries Act authorization for continued operation of the Darlington cooling water system. As part of our environmental assessment follow-up program, we will be monitoring the effectiveness of our mitigation measures. Darlington is also certified by the Wildlife Habitat Council under its Wildlife at Work program and is a repeat recipient of the Corporate Habitat of the Year Award for a comprehensive wildlife habitat management program. Our nuclear management system provides a framework that establishes the processes and programs required to ensure OPG achieves its safety objectives, continuously monitors its performance against those objectives, and fosters a healthy safety culture. Darlington is compliant with CSA Standard N286, management system requirements for nuclear facilities, and will be transitioning to the new version by the end of this year. Internally, we have a well-established corrective action program incorporating self-assessments, benchmarking, and independent audits. Industry peer reviews are also regularly performed at all of our nuclear stations. We periodically evaluate our own safety culture to recognize positive attributes and to identify areas for further improvement. A station-wide assessment conducted at Darlington this year concluded there was a healthy nuclear safety culture, a healthy respect for nuclear safety, and that nuclear safety is not compromised by production priorities. One of our goals is to continue this high level of industry-recognized performance while also taking the opportunity to learn from others' best practices. The objective of our human performance program is to reduce the frequency and severity of events by managing defenses and reducing human errors. Our goal is zero events. This starts with awareness, understanding, and commitment by all levels of the organization. It involves promoting individual and department ownership and accountability. And it drives multifaceted initiatives all the way from the frontline worker to the leadership level. Our training programs are also used to develop and maintain competent personnel to safely operate, maintain, and improve both plant and human performance. We have initiatives underway to address the nuclear industry's demographic challenges, especially in the areas of recruitment and knowledge management. In addition to traditional full-time regular staffing, non-regular hiring strategies have been devised to meet short-term requirements. To ensure a continuing supply of leaders, a company-wide succession planning process is in place to identify and develop leadership talent. Darlington has a proven track record of safe and reliable operating performance. Our operations program ensures the safety of the public, environment, and plant personnel. It also ensures high levels of equipment reliability during both normal operation and accident conditions. This program establishes safe operating practices and processes within all of our facilities. It provides our operators the ability to ensure facilities are operated in compliance with the reactor operating license, the operating policies and principles, safe operating envelope limits, and other applicable regulations and industry standards. In the case that reactor operation deviates from normal, Darlington has abnormal incident manuals, emergency operating procedures, emergency mitigating equipment guidelines, and severe accident management guidelines. One of the best indicators of operating performance is force loss rate. This indicator reflects the overall effectiveness of our operating and maintenance programs. Over the past several years, the four units at Darlington have operated with a low FLR. During the current licensing period, all Darlington units operated with a minimal number of unplanned transients and reactor trips, another strong indicator of operating performance. Periodic inspections are completed on all major components and concrete structures to assure ongoing fitness for service. Component and equipment health is evaluated and trended by means of technical evaluations, inspections, maintenance, and testing in accordance with licensing codes and standards. Major components such as fuel channels, feeders, and steam generators have specific life cycle management programs. These plans are communicated to CNSC staff regularly. We are actively leading the industry on the fuel channel life management project, as well as other fuel channel research and development activities. We are confident that Darlington fuel channels will be safe to operate with margin until each unit comes out of service for refurbishment. CNSC staff have concurred with our position that the Darlington fuel channel components are safe to continue operating to at least 235,000 effective full power hours. As you can see on the slide, this easily meets our needs. Regarding concrete integrity, which has been a topic of interest in previous public hearings, the inspection results from each unit's concrete containment structure inspection campaigns are compared to previous results. No significant changes were observed, and the structures were confirmed to be performing as expected. As I mentioned earlier, the physical design of Darlington incorporates a defense in depth approach with multiple redundant safety systems in place to ensure the safety of the workers, the public, and the environment. Our robust design and modification program ensures the ability of systems, structures, and components to meet and maintain their design basis functions. All design changes are prepared and executed in accordance with our Engineering Change Control, or ECC, process. The ECC program ensures all plant modifications are planned, designed, installed, and commissioned within the parameters of the design basis and plant licensing conditions. Our supply chain works with vendors and closely monitors vendor quality to ensure that equipment procured meets design and quality requirements. Although studies by the Geological Survey of Canada conclude Darlington is located in a region of low seismic activity, the reactors and safety systems are designed and constructed to withstand a severe seismic event. As such, a seismic event is a design basis event, and we have dedicated equipment, systems, and procedures for ensuring safe reactor shutdown and continued fuel cooling. Whether it's an earthquake or a flood, our analysis shows Darlington is safe. We've conducted a comprehensive safety analysis of Darlington, and it has shown the likelihood of a serious accident remains very low. Nonetheless, we will continue to invest to further improve the safety of the station through the implementation of emergency mitigating equipment and safety improvement opportunities. These physical improvements to the plant have been incorporated into the Darlington Probabilistic Safety Assessment, or the PSA. This assessment concludes there is a low public risk and the risk is reducing further. Even in the event of a nuclear incident, our investments would significantly reduce the consequences. When it comes to public safety, we're never satisfied. Following the Darlington refurbishment and continued operation environmental assessment in 2012, the following five modifications are being installed at Darlington to further improve public safety. We're adding a third emergency power generator, a new containment filtered venting system. We are enhancing our powerhouse steam ventilation system, an improved shield tank over protection system, and a new emergency makeup to the heat transport system. These large capital investments will help make a safe plant even safer. We regularly review the safety of the station in likely and unlikely scenarios. The 2015 Darlington PSA results show that the severe core damage frequency for individual hazards is well below the safety goal limit. Moreover, these results are below our safety goal target, which is 10 times tighter than this limit. Similarly, the large release frequency, or LRF, for individual hazards is well below the safety goal limit. All of the LRF results are below our safety goal target, with the exception of seismic hazards. To address this, an action plan is in place to further reduce the estimated seismic risk for Darlington. Our plan includes implementing Phase 2 EME, as well as completing the previously mentioned safety improvements. A measure of the whole site risk associated with Darlington has been estimated using a simplified methodology accounting for all units and hazards. The results for large release frequency for our site-wide risk is better than our safety goal limit for each hazard per unit. The estimated risk is even lower with the benefits of the SIOs. Finally, to facilitate interveners for the upcoming Part 2 public hearing, we have posted a summary of the Darlington PSA results on our website. While our goal is accident prevention, we remain prepared in the event of an emergency. Our readiness to respond to a beyond design basis event has been recognized as industry leading, and our emergency plans have been practiced and integrated with all levels of government. In addition, emergency mitigation equipment is available at both Darlington and Pickering. Procedures are issued, staff are trained, and our response has been practiced in a number of drills and exercises. In accordance with provincial requirements, outdoor public alerting sirens and indoor phone alerting systems are operational in the municipality of Clarington and are tested on a regular basis by the region of Jerome. We're also participating in a wireless public alerting service research and development project that will introduce emergency cell broadcast technology to Canada. A trial is planned in the region of Jerome next year. In response to new requirements, OPG is working with various government organizations on pre-distribution of potassium iodide pills to all residents, businesses, and institutions within the primary zone prior to the end of this year. In addition, potassium iodide pills will be made available to residents within the secondary zone. A media and communications plan will be implemented to support the initiative. Some of that is what I have here. Our biggest test of emergency preparedness took place in 2014. In May, we led the execution of the Exercise Unified Response, where more than 1,000 participants from 54 federal, provincial, municipal, and non-government agencies participated over the course of 3 days. The results demonstrate that there are robust emergency plans in place at all levels to deal with a nuclear emergency. Further enhancements to those plans are being implemented as part of the lessons learned. The following video will provide a better overview of the 2014 Exercise Unified Response and the emergency mitigation equipment.
Safety is Ontario Power Generation's number one priority. As an operator of nuclear power plants, OPG has multiple safety systems in place to prevent a nuclear emergency from ever happening. But creating plans is only one part of preparing for an event. Equally important is the regular testing of those plans, procedures, and capabilities. In May of 2014, Ontario's emergency response capability was strengthened when OPG, municipal, provincial, and federal governments conducted a 3-day mock nuclear emergency exercise. 54 agencies participated, including the Canadian Nuclear Safety Commission, Health Canada, the Province of Ontario, Region of Durham, and Municipality of Clarington. The exercise tested OPG and participating agencies on their response to a simulated nuclear emergency and radioactive release at Darlington Nuclear. The exercise provided OPG the opportunity to test the effectiveness of our on-site response plans and the deployment and operation of the emergency mitigation equipment. OPG's Emergency Operations Center was activated, as were operation centers at the local, regional, provincial, and federal level. As part of the scenario, the province of Ontario ordered a simulated evacuation for local residents, and Durham Region activated the public alerting sirens around the station. Health agencies also participated, with the Ministry of Health and Long-Term Care deploying its emergency medical assistance team, which included a mobile hospital, and Lake Ridge Health Bowmanville simulated treatment of a contaminated casualty. Durham Region established an emergency workers center and liaised with Durham Regional Police Services, who practiced their neighborhood patrol. The federal government also enacted their response plans. Joint operations were conducted by field teams from federal and provincial responders, including teams from Natural Resources Canada that flew over the area with radiation detectors and shared survey information with the province to guide their decision-making. The exercise also tested communications with the public through a simulated media website that was used to provide news articles, radio broadcasts, and twice-daily news video broadcasts, which along with social media inserts made the exercise more realistic for participants. OPG created press releases and emergency bulletins that were posted and shared with other organizations to ensure coordination of public messaging. Exercise Unified Response demonstrated that there is an effective, coordinated response between OPG and the local, regional, provincial, and federal governments and agencies with defined roles in nuclear emergency planning. The lessons learned will be used to enhance the current capability of every nuclear response organization to respond to a nuclear emergency, improving public safety today and throughout the license term.
Darlington has a security program that complies with the CNSC regulatory requirements for ensuring safe and secure station operation. A wide range of state-of-the-art security equipment is deployed around and throughout the Darlington site. Performance testing program exercises are routinely executed to assess the integrated response capabilities of our nuclear security armed and unarmed elements against adversaries equipped and performing within the design basis threat. We also have an off-site response arrangement with the Durham Regional Police Service. We recognize the frequency of cyber threats is increasing for all spectrums of the industry. We take cybersecurity very seriously and have a cybersecurity program that protects our computers and software. The computers used for control and monitoring of our units are segregated from external sources and are therefore protected from external attacks. Darlington is continually working to reduce the amount of low and intermediate level nuclear waste that it produces, thereby reducing our environmental footprint so that future generations will not be unduly burdened. Low and intermediate level waste from Darlington is transported to the Western Waste Management Facility for storage. The Deep Geological Repository, which is currently in the licensing process, will be the long-term storage location for this waste. Darlington has two irradiated fuel bays for storage of used nuclear fuel until it can be transferred to dry storage containers for interim storage at the Darlington Waste Management Facility. We account for each and every fuel bundle stored at Darlington. The Nuclear Waste Management Organization, which was established by the federal government, is developing plans for the long-term disposal facility for used fuel. When this comes into service, used fuel will be transferred from the Darlington site to this new facility. Planning for the eventual decommissioning of Darlington is an ongoing process. The preliminary decommissioning plan is the proposed plan for the eventual decommissioning of Darlington and was prepared in accordance with CNSC and CSA requirements. OPG's financial guarantee ensures that the full costs of future decommissioning will be covered by investments being made during the operation of the plant. The If you've been to the Darlington site lately, you will have noticed the enormous amount of construction activity underway as part of our campus plan. The campus plan is the master plan that supports the current and future uses of the Darlington station, including the needs of refurbishment. The following changes to the Darlington site have been completed or are being implemented. Refurbishment of the operations support building to house my staff. Installation of a new auxiliary heating steam facility to replace our existing aging boiler house, ensure a reliable backup heating supply in the case of a station shutdown in winter. Upgrades to the site electrical power distribution system to support our refurb project and buildings. An upgrade to our water and sewage infrastructure. And finally, a replacement for our water treatment plant to supply high quality demineralized water to our boilers. I will now show a short video of our campus plan and then hand the presentation over to Dietmar, who will discuss the refurbishment project.
OPG is making several infrastructure improvements to support the refurbishment of Darlington Nuclear and 30 more years of operation. These improvements are part of our campus plan project. The campus plan project includes infrastructure upgrades around the site in preparation for an additional 30 years of operation to 2055, such as a new maintenance building, new auxiliary boilers, and the expansion and upgrading of the OSB building. Additional projects support continued improvements as well as the refurbishment project. These projects include improvements made to the Holt Road interchange to facilitate workers getting to and from the station, a new vehicle security screening facility, as well as upgrades to water and sewer infrastructure. Campus plan projects also include prerequisite work for the refurbishment of Darlington, including construction of the D2O storage building, the refurbishment project office, retube and feeder replacement support building, and electrical power upgrades. In total, these and other campus plan projects will employ approximately 300 engineers, 500 tradespeople, and 2,500 building trades jobs through to completion. Completion of the campus plan infrastructure projects is another step towards ensuring Darlington will continue to safely and reliably produce electricity for another 30 years.
Dietmar Reiner, for the record. A senior vice president of nuclear projects, I'm responsible for the dedicated team that is planning and executing the refurbishment of the four Darlington units. The province is depending on us to complete the refurbishment safely, with quality, and on schedule and on budget. In this portion of the presentation, I'll provide an overview of how we plan to do just that. And that's also outlined in our commission member document. And I'll talk about how the project timelines would benefit from a 13-year license. OPG's nuclear plants use CANDU technology. All CANDU reactors require midlife refurbishment of their key components after 25 to 30 years of service. Darlington has been operating for more than 20 years now, providing safe, clean, and reliable baseload electricity for the people of Ontario, and it is nearing its midlife point. Nuclear refurbishment is a significant undertaking that involves the replacement of major reactor components, including pressure tubes, calandria tubes, and feeder pipes. It also involves a tremendous amount of work to be completed in other important areas of the station, including the turbine generator sets and fuel handling equipment, and on many other systems. Darlington refurbishment will be an extensive and complex project spanning about 15 years, and it will ensure the plant can provide clean, reliable baseload power to the province for another 30 years. We've been planning the refurbishment since 2007 and are the first utility to be in full compliance with CNSC regulatory document RD360, entitled Life Extension of Nuclear Power Plants. Specifically, we've completed an environmental assessment that concluded there will be no significant adverse environmental effects given mitigation measures that we are implementing. An integrated safety review that demonstrates Darlington substantively conforms to modern codes and standards with no safety significant gaps. A global assessment which confirmed Darlington is well positioned for safe operation for the next 30 years. An integrated implementation plan which forms the scope and schedule for the regulatory commitments for the refurbishment project. The integrated implementation plan, which is included in the CNSC's commission member document for your approval, contains modifications to improve public safety, the five safety improvement opportunities that Brian talked about earlier, environmental assessment mitigation measures and follow-up program activities, reactor component replacement like fuel channels and feeders, actions to address component condition assessments that were performed to determine which components should be replaced, and code compliance activities that were identified from the integrated safety review to bring the Darlington station up to modern codes and standards. Activities outside the integrated implementation plan include turbine generator upgrades, steam generator cleaning, and balance of plant maintenance and repair work. This slide shows the timeline for refurbishment on the four units. Unit 2 will be the first unit to be shut down for reactor component replacement. This outage will start in October 2016 and last for approximately 3 years. The majority of the refurbishment work on this unit will take place during this outage. But before we start Unit 2, we'll be completing work on four of the five safety improvements that Brian had described earlier in his presentation. The sequence for the other three units is as shown. As you can see in the diagram, the end of refurbishment occurs in 2028 when we have completed all of the regulatory scope documented in the integrated implementation plan. Hence our request for a 13-year license term to 2028. As mentioned by Glenn in his opening remarks, we believe a 13-year operating license is the safest way to manage refurbishment because it would allow all four units to be refurbished under the same set of regulatory requirements. This will enable us to assure nuclear safety through consistency and configuration management between units. We're offering to provide an update to the Commission at public meetings after each unit's refurbishment outage to explain how refurbishment is progressing. Before I leave this slide, though, it's important to note that the integrated implementation plan work is not limited to refurbishment outages and is already underway. We've already completed the scheduled items for 2014 and will complete all items that are scheduled for 2015 by end of this year. All of the integrated implementation plan work activities will be completed by 2028. Return to service from each refurbishment outage covers the range of activities from completion of installation work to the reactor achieving 100% full power. There will be four regulatory restart hold points shown in red that are documented in the proposed license condition handbook. OPG has established five additional restart quality checkpoints as shown in this slide. These hold points and quality checkpoints will ensure that all of the necessary steps and requirements have been completed and that we're ready to proceed to the next steps in the startup process. As mentioned earlier, we're offering to provide an update to the Commission on our progress after each of the unit's refurbishment outages. Quality assurance along with safety is a top priority for a project of this scope and duration. As the licensee, we have overall responsibility for protecting workers, the public, and the environment. This responsibility is something we take very seriously, whether the work is performed by our employees or by contractors. The nuclear refurbishment program is designed to provide assurance that all aspects of the work, from engineering to construction turnover, are conducted in accordance with CSA standard N286, management system requirements for nuclear facilities, and all other applicable standards. The majority of work will be completed by contractors, and we've developed a process that ensures they meet the requirements outlined in the CSA standard N286. The principal contractors will be allowed to use their own quality program and manage quality to applicable standards, This allows the contractors to use systems they're accustomed to as they supervise the work to achieve cost, schedule, and quality deliverables. They will prepare, monitor, and report to us on agreed upon project metrics and implement improvements as required. We will ensure personnel meet expected behaviors through extensive field supervision, task-specific training, job planning, rehearsals on our mock-up facility, for example, sound work procedures, oversight, and the implementation of a continuous improvement program. Also, our contractors are required to have human performance programs that are equivalent to OPGs. As Brian mentioned earlier, a lot of work is being done at the Darlington site in preparation for life extension and refurbishment. We anticipate an influx of over 2,000 additional workers, and we're making significant investments to ensure these workers can get safely and efficiently to and from their job sites. Key to this is the new Darlington Energy Complex, which houses three functions, including a worker onboarding center, where contract workers will complete training and qualification to work in a nuclear environment, a mock-up and training facility which provides workers with real-life training and rehearsals before critical work tasks begin on a reactor face, and a warehouse for component storage, material staging, and pre-assembly. In addition, we're making other site improvements that include road improvements at the Holt Road and Highway 401 interchange, and on Park Road that will allow staff efficient access routes to the site. A new refurbishment project office that provides an efficient and secure entry point for refurbishment workers and parking for about 2,000 vehicles. The retube and feeder replacement island support building provides offices, shops, and material staging areas for the staff that will execute and supervise the retube and feeder replacement activities. And the new vehicle screening facility is helping to expedite traffic through security into the protected area. These site investments reflect our commitment to safe and efficient worker and material flow. I'd also like to highlight another investment we've made for safe and efficient work execution, specifically for retube and feeder replacement. Once a unit is safely shut down and all of the fuel removed, we will drain and dry the calandria and heat transport system. A new storage facility will store the heavy water and will help us manage heavy water for the nuclear fleet. Removing the fuel channels is next. This is automated, and once the fuel channel components are removed, they will be processed at the new retube waste processing building. This building is removed from the reactor face to help reduce worker exposure to radiation. At the retube waste processing building, pressure tubes, calandria tubes, and other related fuel channel components will be further cut, volume reduced, and packed into special containers. The containers will be transferred to the new retube waste storage building until they can be moved to a long-term management facility like the Deep Geological Repository. Other refurbishment low and intermediate level waste, including feeder pipes, will be transferred directly to OPG's Western Waste Management Facility, as is the current practice for operational low and intermediate level waste. Replacing the fuel channels and feeder pipes inside of each of the reactors safely and efficiently is critical to the success of refurbishment. To accomplish this work properly, highly trained workers will use uniquely designed and carefully calibrated tools. Much of the work will be performed in tight spaces and under challenging conditions. To address this, we've developed an industry-leading approach to testing tools and training staff ahead of the actual work on the reactor face. We've built a world-class training facility that includes a full-scale reactor mock-up of a Darlington unit. The mock-up accurately represents the size and space constraints within the reactor vault and simulates all physical interferences that could be encountered during the refurbishment. And we're already seeing the benefits of this. Specialized tools have been designed and built. The new tools have been tested and proven to determine the correct time and precise sequence needed to execute each activity in the refurbishment process. This will help establish the detailed schedule for the project, increase productivity, and enhance project certainty as well as safety. And we will incorporate lessons learned as we move on to subsequent unit refurbishments. We're extremely proud of this facility. And before I hand the presentation back over to Glenn to wrap up, I'd like to show you a short video to give you a first-hand look at the mock-up.
Ontario Power Generation's state-of-the-art training facility inside the Darlington Energy Complex houses a full-scale mock-up of a Darlington reactor. This is a technologically advanced facility where staff are training for the biggest project that OPG has undertaken. The reactor mock-up is designed and built in cooperation with our vendors to actually represent the size and space constraints within the Darlington reactor vault and simulate all the structural interferences that will be encountered during the actual retube and feeder replacement work. Not only the vault, but every door, pipe, hallway, and overhead light has been replicated. This will allow the workers to familiarize themselves with every inch of the reactor vault. They will practice the work, perfect techniques, perform full dress rehearsals using actual tools and wearing protective equipment before they begin work inside the station. Workers, procedures, and tools will be fully tested at the training facility before the execution work begins at the Darlington station. This full-scale mock-up provides workers with the ultimate training tool to hone their skills before entering the units at Darlington. High-quality training with the right tools in the right environment will help maximize efficiency and minimize costs. This type of upfront investment is a key to our approach to managing the Darlington refurbishment project.
Glenn Jager again, once again for the record. To summarize, I hope this presentation has given you some sense of why Darlington is one of the top performing nuclear stations in the world. It's been recognized for outstanding performance by some of the most prestigious organizations in the industry. Its reactors consistently rank among the top performing CANDU units globally. It's been a leader in the development of innovative maintenance and operational processes like the 3-year outage cycle. Plus, it generates roughly 20% of the electricity annually consumed in Ontario, which is enough power to serve a city of 2 million people. Throughout its lifetime, it's produced over 500 terawatt hours of energy, all of it virtually free of emissions, contributing to smog and climate change. That is a tremendous amount of power. Even with this high performance, we have continued to improve and invest in the station. All of this makes the station a great candidate for refurbishment and one of the province's best performing and most important infrastructure assets. We believe that our strong performance, our safety culture, our operating performance, our continuous improvements and innovation, and finally our community support all make us qualified to continue operations to December 1st, 2028. We've made provisions for the protection of the environment, the health of workers and the public, and our international obligations. A 13-year license will allow OPG to complete a periodic safety review and a license renewal with all units completed to the same configuration at the end of refurbishment. A 13-year license allows us to operate under a consistent licensing basis throughout the project. Operations staff are trained to execute a plan to completion which maximizes safety. The safest place to be is on the plan, not changing the plan midstream. This is a complex project managing multiple configurations throughout the life of the project, and it's essential that a consistent licensing basis exists throughout this period. A 13-year license is the best and safest approach. Thank you.
Thank you.